Yes. Now we will talk about the panel discussion, and then in this panel discussion, normally the participants, they are supposed to be the experts. So what trainer can do, he can identify from the trainees who are the experts in a particular topic and then ask them. So it is a basic purpose of this session is the knowledge sharing. So many times in the training program, you are having the experts from the different areas. So it is not only the trainer who speaks, but it is the trainees, those who are participants, because of their vast knowledge and experience, they should be also given an opportunity to address the rest of the participants. So here I will now again request my students to introduce themselves.
Hello everyone, I am Deepak. I am Deepak Patidar. I am from Indore. I did my engineering in mechanical stream from RGB University. Currently I am pursuing my MBA from Department of Management Study IIT Roorkee, and my specialization is finance and marketing. I did my summer internship from Cremica Food Industries as a financial analyst. Thank you.
I am Sahil Jatale and I am from Indore. I did civil engineering from Acropolis Institute of Technology and Research, Indore, and currently I am pursuing masters from Department of Management Studies IIT Roorkee. My specializations are HR and marketing. I was a summer intern at Middle Earth HR in the field of HR and marketing.
Hello everyone, my name is Shubham Dhakat. I belong to Jaipur. So I did my BTech from mechanical engineering from Jaipur itself, and I'm currently pursuing my MBA here at Department of Management Studies IIT Roorkee in the fields of operations and HR. I did my summer internships in Taffe Motors and Tractors Limited from Bhopal as a management training.
Good.
Hello everyone, I am Sneshish Khan from Kolkata. I completed my computer science engineering BTech from Meghnakshi Institute of Technology. I am presently pursuing MBA from Department of Management Studies IIT Roorkee. I completed my summer internship in the role of marketing from Reliance Jio.
Hello everyone, I am Mohit Verma. I am born and brought up in Delhi. I did my BTech from Maharaja Agrasen Institute of Technology, Delhi. I have come here to study management, and I am doing my MBA in the field of marketing and operations at the Department of Management Studies, IIT Roorkee. I did my summer internship at Hexagon India, which is a part of Hexagon AB, a Swedish company. I've worked there as a sales and marketing strategist and analyst.
Good. So now they have introduced, and now they will participate as an expert, and the panel discussion will start.
Hello everyone. Our trainer has provided the topic of India 2030 for this panel discussion, and I'll be moderating it. So with me, I have Mrs. Sneha Sheesh as an expert of telecom. Then I have Mr. Mohit as an expert in railways. Then Mr. Deepak as an expert in finance and banking. And then finally, Mr. Sahil as an expert in human resource development. So firstly, I like a starting argument by everyone. So starting from Mr. Deepak, what is your point of view towards India 2030?
Like India is an emerging economy, as everybody knows in the world. And as we part as a finance expert, I can see, because it is a very important pillar for any country as a economic development, because until unless we don't have any resources, kind of money and this kind of resources, we cannot grow. So in recent few years, like last five years, India has Indian government, and they have taken a rapidly, they have taken the steps which reform the financial structure. Like if you talk about like IBC, insolvency and bankruptcy code. So this is related to NPS, to control non-performing assets and all. Second is they are working on the financial institutions like bankings, private banks, and as well as PSBs, public sector bankings. So PSBs, they are also taking very hard steps for them to control NPS. Like out of 21 PSBs, 14 PSBs are under PCA, prompt corrective actions. So this is also government has taken the steps for them, and to get rid of this, they are doing the amalgamations kind of things. Like recently, there is a three banks were combined in a single entity, like Dena Bank and the Vijaya Bank, Dena Bank, and OBC. So
let's have more information and more perspective by Mr. Sahil regarding the India 2030 and what kind of development MHRD has planned out.
Okay, so human resource is the tool for any developing nation.
it is the wealth basically. So what we are planning is that currently the education sector in India is estimated to be around 90 billion and it is growing $90 billion, and currently it is growing at an annual rate of more than 11%. So what we think that in the upcoming years education sector shall be our key focus areas, and currently what we generally have the data is that more than 250 million students are school going in India. So we have to plan out for them because they are ultimate the nation builders for the country. Okay. So we are planning some online courses, training modules, and what technology has to offer, and how can we reduce the unemployment rate in India. That is the key concern for our department.
So next I'll go to Mr. Snehashish regarding what will be the telecom's role in the development of India 2030.
To understand what the future will bring, we first have to look at the past. So in the last 1 year, Vodafone and Idea have merged into a single entity, and within India there exists only three major telecom players: Vodafone Idea, Airtel, and Reliance Jio. Vodafone Idea is presently entering into the premium segment, wherein they have discontinued a significant number of customers who had plans of less than rupees 90 per rupees 100 per month. Airtel, on the other hand, has entered into the television business and some other verticals. Reliance Jio is focusing on penetration into the rural market, which until now has not had significant internet exposure. As far as the future is concerned, we expect significant penetration of internet services in rural areas of India, thereby providing connectivity to people who were not connected from before.
All right. So, Mr. Mohit, now as you have dealt in the lifeline of our country, railways, so what do you think that railways will bring for India 2030?
Well, railways is just a branch of the transportation sector of India. By 2030, we believe that transportation in the form of logistics and the passenger movement will enforce the GDP of India. India by 2030 is poised to become the second largest economy in the world. We will be surpassing USA. And to boost this kind of growth rate, we need to have some infrastructure in the form of not just railways, in the form of shipping, roadways, airline industries as well. However, if we look at the airline industry, we see that new airlines have come up in the scenario of Indian transportation sector. Government is now enforcing the scheme of Udaan, which is also called as Ude Desh Kaam Nagrik, which is to enforce the and boost actually the transportation sector or aviation sector in particular. However, in the railways, we are seeing the rapid developments in the form and acceptance of technology. For instance, now we are becoming more customer friendly while we are and providing the services like Train 18, which was launched in 2018. And now we are also planning a Train 20 project, which is destined to be entering the service of Indian Railways by 2020. However, in long run, in 2030, we have projects like bullet train, and now we are also exploring the projects like Hyperloop from in Bangalore.
All right. So now let's beginning the discussion. Mr. Deepak, what do you think that the last 5 years of financing and banking industry will it impact the India 2030 plan?
So if I talk about the different pillar of the finance only, the government has taken the steps in all pillars, like recapitalization of banks. Okay, government has issued 2 lakh crore in their budget of 2017, and they already issued 1.5 lakh crore to banks to come out from prompt corrective actions, like bank cannot lend their money up to certain limit. Mm-hmm. So out of 21 banks, 14 were under the PCA, but now recently, just because of recapitalization, their strength has increased and they can lend money, and then they come out from the PCA. Second thing is their amalgamation of the banks. Recently, there is a news, like a day before yesterday, there is a news, three banks like PNB, PSB and OBC, they are also going to merge. So if they will merge, then the operation will be smooth, and the power center will be the single power center, decision center will be the one. that will impact a lot and that will like a constraint on the NPS.
How do you think that this will actually empower the people of India in developing themselves so that they can prosper in India 2030?
Important thing is that the financial institutions are very important for the people as well as the for government, because they drive the economy. They generate the resources for the people, so that government can come with the so many social policies for the people.
Mm-hmm.
Like recently there is a policy of health insurance. This is also backed up by the financial institution. Until they don't have financial institution backed up, government cannot come with this kind of policies.
Mm-hmm.
So this is the backed up by the this kind of policies, and that's why this will prosper.
Do you think India can sustain these policies by till 2030?
Yeah, definitely. If they because the significant efforts has been put on this, and there are so many experts apart from politicians, so many IIMs, IAS kind of people are in this kind of policies, and they are doing exceptionally well. They are putting their hard work there, and they are very innovative in that context.
Now we have seen that the government and the finance and the banking industry is ready to support the future Indian citizens, but how can they develop the skills to actually prosper in the future coming years? How is the MHRD planning out, Mr. Sahil?
Okay, so well, there are 21 IITs currently running and 20 IIMs running in the in the country. So these are the institutes which provide the niche or the decision makers of the country. So we are planning to build upon this resource as a whole, increase the seats by 10%, and also build up some more IITs and IIMs so that we could provide a good facility to students who are ready to pursue their careers. So we are focusing and giving good budgets to them for as far as the research is concerned. Along with the training is concerned, we are providing them resources so where students who cannot turn up there can physically cannot attend, but through use of technology. We are building upon the technology as well. NPTEL courses are going on, then some other courses are going on through which students can enroll and see and get trained himself according to his need. So if a person wants to be trained in say management, so he is not able to come up to a certain level or join an institute, he can sit at home, get that education, not physical but in terms of practical as well.
So 10% increase in the size of the IITs and the IIMs in the terms of the student population.
Yeah.
Do you think it's actually acceptable for the next next 11 years?
Okay.
So will there be an increment plan or this it's just static at 10%?
So, for as far as the current scenario is concerned, the population of the country is growing at a good rate. So, we need to project and we need to see that how effectively can we implement, because we don't have that much of infrastructure. This is the initial level that we'll initiate, will open the boundaries to more students so that these people built upon their careers and they could also do well in their lives.
And will the
later
IITs
on, IITs and IIMs will also build upon more number of seats. And we are planning to increase and diversify them, not only in terms of the management or engineering is concerned, but also the research work.
But again, the question rises whether you are compromising with the quality in terms of quantity. How will you compensate that?
We are trying to balance both in terms of quality and in quantity.
Okay, what are the policies that you guys are planning?
Okay, so we are going through a very thorough and very quick selection of the faculties as well, because ultimately who will train the students? We need the faculties, that is the human resource capital of the country. So we need very good minds from the country who will build upon those resources, and we are ready to support them in whole way. And technology is definitely playing a good role.
So as Mrs. Sahil told that they are developing an e-platform for the education of the population of India 2030. So how is the telecom industry going to help them out, or how are they going to develop on it?
As far as the telecom industry is concerned, we have noticed that there is a significant demand for internet services both in urban and rural India. As of now, urban India has been almost completely saturated with at least basic telecommunication services.
Mm-hmm.
But we are still expanding our internet network both in terms of speed as well as capacity. Moreover, in rural India, we are ensuring expansion of basic telecom services as well as internet services and other value-added services as well. As such, as I believe online courses and such will will the popularity of online courses will increase significantly due to the efforts of telecom industry.
Okay, will the future coming telecom industry will actually help the MHRD or only sell their product of like their internet packages to the students? Because as we have seen, most of our population is still very poor. They mostly live in rural areas. They cannot yet sustain themselves to the level that they can buy your packages again and again and then go for courses. You should, like, are you planning any collaborations there so that the students can actually reap benefits?
As of now, there are no collaborations existent. However, we are open to a possibility of collaboration provided that all our strategic objectives are fulfilled.
All right. So, Mr. Sahil, you have a point to raise.
Yeah. So, as we have made compulsory, as the government of India has made compulsory 2% of their profits in CSR, so companies like Tata and Google have come up with us with a project that will build 100,000 railway stations, this connectivity through internet. So, we have given other companies who have approached to us that you should provide these services of your internet, not only in railway station, you can expand till rural areas. Because in urban areas, it is the internet services have reached almost, but we want to reach to each and every single home. So this is the vision which government of India has for 2030.
Maybe the telecom industry and the MHRD can develop on this solution. But we have ignored Mr. Mohit till now. So what do you think the plan of railways will be for 2030?
Plan of railway is simple. We want faster transportation and we want safer transportation.
Mm-hmm.
For faster transportation, we are developing the technologies in the field of semi-high-speed trains. And we are adopting the technology from Japan as well. And now we are also exploring the research in the area of Hyperloop. So we believe that by 2030, we'll actually be having multiple bullet trains running across India, not just from Mumbai to Ahmedabad, but maybe from Delhi to Mumbai as well, maybe from Bangalore to Pune as well.
So what is your comment about the technologies that we are importing to our country, but is it sustainable for us? Because coming years, if the technology gets more expensive for us, it's a bad proposal for us, for our future as well. So what is your comment on that?
Well, definitely when you say the cost of the bullet train project, you have such questions. But the thing is, we are actually trying to develop an ecosystem in the country. We are not just importing it for one time. We look these as a major transportation of the country in the future.
Mm-hmm.
So I believe that the cost is initially high. However, we have developed certain institute as well, railway university as well in Vadodara. And we believe that after a certain amount of time, our, you know, citizens and proudful youth of India will be able to develop these technologies in the home.
Okay, maybe Mr. Deepak could shed some light regarding the finances of these plans.
Okay.
Regarding to budgets and all.
Yeah.
Yeah, so recently government is also very enthusiastic regarding to railways, and they are projecting the new projects, and they are the budget has been increased. And last 2 years, if you see that the budget has been collaborated. Before that, railway budgets were explicitly was presented in the parliament, but now it is collaborated because
mm-hmm.
the whole because the government is looking the value chain of entire countries,
mm-hmm.
entire functions. Okay, they don't want to be separate anything. Just because of that, they are communicating everything and then they are locating the budget.
Mm-hmm.
So you can see that we have raised the fund from the Japan. On a very 0.01% for the bullet train.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a part of finance and everything. So how to back up all the policy with the help of finance. We recently we have launched the Train 18. Everybody knows about it. So it is also a government's visionary plan. And now it is going and government is about to complete bullet by 2030. And so that we have faster.
So Mr. Sahil, you were raising a point. So what do you want to add or correct?
I would like to know from Mohit that what MHRD can support the railway system. So because people are educating from the institutes, but they are not getting the proper skills. So we want to know and we want to build upon those skills for the youth of the India.
So any counters, Mr. Mohit?
I believe that MHRD has helped enough for right now, but there are certain areas that we can explore together. As I've already mentioned, that Indian Railways just built a National Railway University at Vadodara. The talent pool that we obtain from these universities will be specifically for the railway industry. However, earlier we have a system for civil service exams where Indian Railway Service for mechanical engineers and signals and transportation and other fields branches were exclusively selected and trained alongside the other, you know, students from different universities.
Now, till the discussion that has been till now, I find it relatively close in like next 4 years, next 5 year kind of planning. But I want to know, as a, like every Indian would want to know, that what in India 2030 we would expect. For example, the pollution has been rising to another levels. The smart city promise has yet to be completed. There has been no particular proposals regarding it.
Okay.
Now, bank liabilities, we already have too much liabilities in terms of the international loans. What kind of planning we want to know about that? So I want to know your comments on that. So starting from Mr. Mohit.
Well, I said we were thinking of safer transportation.
Mm-hmm.
Safer is not only in the terms of accidents, it's also in the term of air pollution reduction in the society. Well, Indian Railways, if you have heard of it, they have actually transformed a diesel engine into a totally electric engine.
Mm-hmm.
We have developed this technology in India thanks to the youth of India. We are able to do that, and we are exploring the, you know, electrification of the railway tracks, so that we don't have to depend on the diesel that's import or the petroleum fuel that is.
So still, I find it very small initiative of your. Although I appreciate it, but I find it very small initiative. I have like, we already know that in various European nations they have already shifted in the like roadways in the industry, in the logistics regarding to roadways, for example, trucks. So they have shifted from the fossil fuel running trucks to completely electric trucks, and they are completely streamlining this process. So although India has a lag in the conversion of technology from outside to to being indigenized, so what do you think the lag will be by converting those electric like bringing those electric trucks to our country as such?
Okay,
what will be the complete timeline and what will be the obstacles regarding it?
So if you want to run railways, you need to lay the tracks first, and then you have to electrify the sections as well. For instance, we have this electrification project is not a small project, it's a nationwide project. So we have also imported GE locomotives, General Electric locomotives. We have the $60-70 billion project called Delhi Mumbai Industrial Corridor, which is dedicated to only freight corridor.
Okay.
Dedicated freight corridor from Delhi to Mumbai.
So how will this snowball in the future?
Well, the current pace of, you know, the logistics movement is very slow compared to what we will be in the future. Almost it will be double the current speed.
Okay. So
I'm completely Shubham, I'm completely agree with my friend Mohit. Like, initiatives are very small at this point, but it will go up to a certain period of time, it will become a large.
That's the reason
and,
why we are here.
Yeah.
We want
and
to know how
of
will
all,
it snowball.
The important point which you have is that the liabilities, country's liability. So we have restrained our fiscal deficit by 3.4%. This time we pegged our 3.4%. Last year we pegged by 3.2%. So what is the difference? What is this fiscal deficit is that the government is an entity which are taking the money in the terms of taxes, and they are spending in the welfare of the like budget kind of thing. Of citizens. So the difference between this 3.4%, because that whatever money we have collected from in the terms of taxes, whose 3.4% we are raising from outside our country, like World Bank or IMF or some other entities. Okay. So it is a good signal for the country. Until unless we want to be developed, we are a developing economy and we are developing with 7.8% of average GDP. So this is a very good indication for the country that we have a fiscal deficit, because it is an indication of our infrastructure development. So that we are raising the fund and we are very restricted, our country is very disciplined in terms of deficit.
Now,
fiscal
this
deficit
is a situation that's geopolitical, but I want to know what the banks have also liabilities inside India as well.
Yeah, let me complete it. First thing is this. Second thing is that we also taken the steps, very important step for prospering the people, for supporting people, like Mudra. Mudra is the initiative we give. One can Mudra is the initiative of financial institution itself, MSMEs people can get the loan up to 10 lakh rupees so that they can increase their capacity or they increase their businesses. Secondly, PSL, public sector lending, priority sector lending. So there are certain sectors are under that, like agriculture, education and MSMEs. These are the sector which are under the umbrella of PSL, where every bank has to have a quota for that and they have to lend them only. Okay, like so 10%, 20% of their total loan, they cannot give all on the big corporate houses.
Will these
they have to
umbrella consider the entrepreneurs, the local producers? Will these include those?
Yeah. MSM is like medium sector.
That means the entrepreneurs are being enforced by your policies as well.
Yeah. And apart from that, we are losing norms in GST as well. We have given a lot of release to MSME sectors of GST. We increased their limits. Like before they have to pay 30 lakh of them, now they are limited till 50 lakh of their revenue.
So
these are the steps, very important steps, and in the long run this will definitely help the India and this will prosper the country.
Now people, considering that our financial expert and our railway expert, we can even say that they have knowledge about logistics as well. Now what is the take of MHRD regarding that?
So earlier we used to run a campaign called School Chale Abhiyan, but now we are building upon that. We have now went to smart education, so that students just don't just physically require a teacher, but through the use of technology, we are making this thing compulsory for every CBSE affiliated school, which will further in the coming 5 years, all the state governed schools should also implement this thing. So this will enhance the quality of education that we could provide to students, and further the problem of unemployment can be solved. Also, we have gone through a skill development training session. So through that, the experts throughout the world can put up their we have built a platform where experts will put up their training sessions, where people will get physical training or they can take it online as well.
But the question remains again that India 2030 expects a newer education system. Our education system can be said one of the worst, because it does not create that creativity or the kind of skill that today's generation requires for future prosperity. Today's generation requires knowledge of various IT IT technologies, various, I would say, the workings of the industry as such. The biggest gap that has, like again and again told by industry, that academia does not follow the trends that we follow. So how MHRD is planning to cover that?
So,
because it has to go from the basic level, from the school level, the people, the students, our nation's builders have to be trained in that method.
So what we have done, government has formed a separate skill development ministry. So what that ministry is governing is that in every district, they have started opening that particular training programs where people will be trained in the specific training they require, whether it be 2 months, 3 months, depending upon the capability.
Here you mark the people as the people who are adult or teens, or do you mark as the students, the younger ones?
See, basically education is the tool, then we can build upon it. We are changing the education system, like people will have online exams. We are supporting the environment sustainable concern as well. So we are taking back the older methods of education, and now the students will be facing directly interacting with the technology, not only in terms of examination but in the terms of their classes as well.
Alright.
So students will be trained in their technological
now,
aspect.
Before taking any more points, I want to ask Mr. Snehashish what his take was regarding the discussion till now.
As far as the telecom sector is concerned, we are trying to create a digital ecosystem wherein people, consumers all over the country, all our citizens will have access to digital content, both educational and non-educational, at all times. We are also working on reducing the cost per consumer, the cost borne by the consumer through investment in greenfield technology that reduces the variable cost, which will be transferred to a consumer. As such, we expect that over the years, over the next 10 years, there will be significant penetration of digital content across India, and the cost of the content will also reduce over the years.
We have seen a lot of time that the trickle down effect the telecom industry presents to India, because it was the telecom industry that brought us IT services, that made us a kind of an IT giant in the world. So I feel that telecom industry is very essential for technology influx of our nation. So what do you think will be the technology technological development in the telecom industry and how it will impact the future India?
Until last year, India had a most Indian telecom industry mostly ran on legacy systems, which are more or less obsolete. They had a low fixed cost, but a very high variable cost, which was transferred to consumers. However, due to its investment in greenfield technology, we now see that there is a very high fixed cost, an investment over 2 lakh crore, but there is a very low variable cost which is now incurred by consumers. Consumers can now get 30 to 40 GB of internet for at less than 100 to 200 rupees a month, which could not even be dreamed of a few years ago. Okay. As such, we expect that in a few years, people will have access to telecom services, consistent and telecom services at any location in the country at very low prices.
So before the statement of Mr. Sneashish, I saw Mr. Mohit and Mr. Deepak raise their point. So I'll firstly ask Mr. Mohit, what was your point that you wanted to add to the discussion?
Well, I was thinking that the paradigm that we are living in for the education sector, I think by 2030 it will be quite different from today. For instance, the literacy rate and the scale we use to measure the literacy rate in India will be totally different. We won't be just saying that people who can read, speak and write in a certain language are literate in that language. We will be using what will be the disposable, you know, uses of those kind of education.
Mm-hmm.
Education sector will probably evolve. We acknowledge that, but I think the growth we will be seeing will be incremental, not very rapid.
Mm-hmm.
So this is true for all the other sectors as well. Either for the communication sector as well, for the transportation sector as well, or the finance sector as well. The growth we're seeing in the next 10 years will be incremental, not rapid.
So again, the question becomes that I know that as the saying goes, as slow and steady wins the race.
Mm-hmm.
But how much slow and how much steady? Because other nations are as well growing.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe we say that we are the IT giant today. Maybe other country would be other IT giant at next time. We need to maintain our lead. So what will be this what will decide this rate that we should go for the development?
Okay, I want to add that first, that we are not leading in education, we are not leading in railways or finance or communication sector. We are not leading anywhere. However, we are seeing ground changes happening in the country.
Mm-hmm.
You see the advent of totally different technology in the country. We have been talking about metro rail projects. You see, they have actually transformed how the people in Delhi travel. Approximately, you can see the transformation of DTC, Delhi Transport Corporation. It's not the most preferred, public transport system in Delhi now. We see Ahmedabad rapid transport system. We are seeing metro acceptance in Kochi, Bangalore, and now in Lucknow as well. The thing is, the changes that we are seeing are actually going to be in the, acknowledgement of what the people of the country are, what the people of country will do in the future.
Okay, Mr. Deepak, you had a point.
Actually, I want to narrow down my friend's point, Mohit's point, because he was talking about what are the skills and how we gonna measure everything. I want to narrow down is that our nation is doing exceptionally good on higher education kind of things. We are all the top class IITs, IIMs, AIIMS and in law college, in fashion design, everywhere we have top institution of in government, but we are lacking on the ground level, like primary education in there. So there is a huge inequality between the CBSE, NCERT, ICSE and state board kind of. In state board also there is a government schools which are not efficiently run by the government. Still the budget is allocated to them, but this is not materializing in a way which is required. So this is the that is the pillar where we are lacking, and that is the learning process of the student where we are lacking. So my point is that what initiative our government is going to take and how we will remedy of this problem.
So the last point I would say, make it please.
So as Mr. Mohit has said that our country is going to incremental changes, I would say in the past 5 or 6 years cities like Indore, cities like Bhopal, and small cities have bypassed Chandigarh and bigger cities in terms of their cleanliness is concerned. This has come only through education. So ministry has implementing such courses in the curriculum of the students, that student who are the nation builders shall be conceptualized now itself, that what is the essential of cleanliness today, that we our what we used to allocate government hospitals, that has been lessened just because of the changes in the patterns of what consumer used to dispose of their waste. So education is the tool, and the youths are the nation builders
so
for any country.
I believe after hearing out all your expert points and your knowledge regarding the topic, I find that there is a common theme regarding the necessity of development of infrastructure and the necessity of development of our human resource infrastructure as well. So I find a very I was notified about very good policies that financially have been pointed out, and they say that we are very good in the financial position, we have very good financial position in the world, so we need to not to worry, only there will be good times coming up.
Yes,
also in terms of the logistics and operations, and in the terms of transportation, you have pointed out that we are moving towards more green technology, so the pollution that we are generating will lessen out. So that count fulfills my curiosity. Also, the good things are coming out of telecom industry as well, as they say that the technology will grow at a very rapid pace, and it will further decrease the cost that our citizen faces in accessing internet, and will increase the coverage through the rural industry. So the common theme, I find that again, the very necessity is the knowledge and the development of our human resource, and their training for the future is very necessary. So thank you.
Thank you.
So at the outset, I congratulate the participants and the moderator. That is, the wonderful presentation and participation has been done. And I am also sure that is, you must have noticed the difference between, you must have seen my earlier modules also, and that is about the group discussion and the brainstorming session, and now it was the panel discussion. And they have prepared a very strongly on their areas where they have to speak, and they have expressed their opinion and given a very good vision about the Vision India 2030. And as a finance expert, HR expert, right, and definitely the railway, transportation and telecom, and I believe that is the way they have presented, you must have also enjoyed. And this way we can take the benefit of the trainees, those who are participating in the training program. So it should not be one way only from the trainer, but the trainees, those who are the expert in their areas, they have to be invited, and there should be this type of the panel discussions, and then you can identify that is the moderator who has taken very good initiative and talked to all the participants and encouraged them, and they have, so we can find out. Otherwise what will happen, trainees will come, they will learn participate in the training program just as a trainee, and they will go back. But what will happen, that is we will not be able to get the knowledge of the experts of the trainees also. So whenever the trainers get an opportunity to learn from the trainees also, he should not miss that opportunity. That is the message. And please plan wherever possible, wherever you observe that you are having the profile of your trainees, and then maybe the young blood also, and learn from them and ask them to come and participate, and everybody should learn. So that was the purpose of this panel discussion, and I am very much satisfied, and hopefully you must have also enjoyed this panel discussion. So again, thanks to all of you.
Thank you.
Right,
thank you.
Wonderful, and thank you very much.
Thank you.